Good evening, viewers. My name is Frankie Fernandez, and welcome to Ghazali, our entertainment program on Prudent Media. I'm based in Melbourne, Australia. My guest, who you would know shortly, is right now in Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur. She's an author, she's a writer, a celebrity in her own charm. Please welcome Ethel Da Costa.
Frankie, this is such a pleasure, and this is so so nostalgic for me to know that we've been colleagues for such a long time in a past life of ours, and we are here in two different countries, two different sides of the planet, and amazing what technology can do. Hi everyone in Goa too.
Absolutely. Now, to start off with, Ethel, you left India about a year and a half, just around the COVID time. And all of a sudden, you were out there when everyone was in lockdown. You took seriously into writing books. And you released your second book, which is already available globally. Tell us a little bit about it.
Right. So I think the Malaysia, the Malaysia travel or journey for me was ordained. I think it was already pre-planned by God, by universe, whatever, call it. I was, my plan was get into Malaysia in March, do whatever that I had to do in terms of my, business recces that was all planned, meetings and things like that. Come back to India, send all of my things from Bombay back to my Goa home, and then fly back into Malaysia again. And I tell you, Frankie, I landed at the airport. Everyone was talking about COVID, this and COVID, that. And I said, nah, I am not bothered about it. I'm just going to go and do what I feel in my gut I'm supposed to go and do. And in 5 days' time, Malaysia announced a total lockdown of the country with airports shut and borders shut. And I was like, oh my God, I have not even set up my meetings, correct? And I have, I had a flight back, Malaysia Airlines flight back to India at the end of the month in March. Everything just came to a grinding halt, which I had not planned for at all. I was like, what do I do now? There's no way that I can panic, though my mom at home panicked. I was like, no, mama, I'm here. I think God has got me here for a reason. I'm just going to figure this out now, And I was so comfortable, Frankie. It was completely scary for everyone, saying, how are you so comfortable in a country that you've barely lived in, that way. I was completely comfortable. I'm not scared at all. I think I just handled COVID like a champ.
Absolutely. You've done it in your own sweet style. Now, traveling for you is nothing. Different. You've traveled places, okay.
Yes.
But setting up in Malaysia and immediately doing something that you're always good in, writing, and you started writing a book. How did that come up?
Yes. So I think that's a very interesting journey because, in the time that I was locked into Malaysia, with everything just completely shut down. So Kuala Lumpur was like a ghost town, not a soul out. And I was like, what do I do with this time that I have now, right? How do I make, turn it to my advantage? Because that's always how my head works. So I said, wait a minute. I said, I'm a writer. I mean, that's what, all our journeys have been. That's what it is all. It's just that I've worn so many different other hats along with it. And I said, okay, so my first story that I wrote in May 2020 was, as soon as Malaysia had announced the lockdown, all the Malaysian travel and tourist affected community and professionals went completely jobless because they lost their jobs en masse at the same time, right? So from there, two of the tourist guys were people who I knew. And I kind of got talking to them and I saw a story developing. I just wrote the story for my website, saying that the lockdown has caused some, 5,000-6,000, loss of jobs. So that many people have suddenly been, rendered redundant by COVID. And and story went out. It was widely shared. I tell you, Frankie, that story got was received by the tourism minister of Malaysia, Madam Nancy Shukri, within 24 hours. The story reached to her. Yes. And she acted on that story. So the story was released on Saturday. By Monday, she had actioned that story, saying, you know, Ethel Acosta is in our country, in Malaysia. And she has written that these many tourist, you know, personnel or people have lost jobs. Where did she get this number from? Let's find out, because why don't we have this data? And she called for all the, you know, for all the associations were called for a meeting. And that's when I understood, saying, hey, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I didn't look back. I said, COVID or no COVID, I am just writing. And that's what I did, Frankie. And eventually, as I was writing, you know, an international publisher saw my work and reached out to me saying, we see a potential for this book to go global because your writing style is so different from what we are reading, you know, in the section or vertical of food. It is very spiritual, it's very passionate, and, you know, you seem to be having such a good time, you know, and the chefs have like opened up so much to you. So we think it's a book in the making. I was like, if you're not kidding, I'm game.
Exactly.
And the book happened. Yes.
And what's the response been, especially in a country like US?
Yes.
Where you had your last release. How has the response been there?
So we did, you know, I used the pandemic to my advantage. So the book was launched online. And we launched it, I think, very, very beautifully. It was launched online in the US. It was launched online, even in India, all online, where people kind of got together and, you know, we did the launch. It is received very well with the international community, because they suddenly are looking at Malaysia now in a very different light. Because, you know, as global travelers themselves, they want new experiences. They want things to kind of feel, you know, from a very deep, you know, soul level or heart level. And I believe food is the way to, you know, to speak to that, you know, to that sensibility. In Paris, I had a very close friend of mine who I had met during IFI in Goa, Shashi, actually took my book and presented it to the ambassador of Malaysia in Paris. And that was really huge. Yeah, that was awesome. And, you know, and so the ambassador of Malaysia also in Paris has the book. And he was like, oh my God, you know, she is doing so much for us, like a default ambassador, by taking stories of Malaysia out to the world, you know, to a very international community on travel, food and people.
Absolutely, yes. Absolutely. And when we get to know that your book has received such a wide acclaim, It for me as a Goan, it's only a matter of like saying, oh, Ethel is doing really, really well out there. And on that note, let me ask you, you are sort of an unofficial brand ambassador of India to Malaysia. Okay.
Thank you.
And you've been interacting with some of the top notch in Malaysia. How have they reciprocated with you?
I must say, Frankie, that Malaysia has thrown the red carpet for me ever since I stepped into the country, because Malaysia was introduced to me by the Malaysia government when they invited me as part of the media, you know, media fam group, as they call it. That happened in 2019 when they just launched the Visit Malaysia 2020 program. I was one of the journalists who was invited from India, some three of us. And we just kind of clicked because I saw so much of similarity between Malaysia and Goa. It was like completely home, you know, for me. And we kind of, you know, built such a fantastic rapport because they invited me back again in February 2020. And by that time, I kind of, you know, had a very close relationship developing, you know, with the country and, of course, you know, the government officials of tourism, Malaysia Tourism. And they just welcomed me. The people just welcomed me as one of them. I think that is the beauty of Malaysia. Very organically, very naturally. They see, you know, I think an affinity. And I believe, you know, put love out, you only receive love back. It's just as simple as that, you know. So when I go out with love, you know, and generosity and, you know, and friendship in my heart to everybody, doors just opened. And doors opened in places where even, you know, and I'm not posting this, even local Malaysians have no access to. And they were like, how the hell did you do that, you know? We've been here all this time and we don't know, you know, X, Y, Z that you know and your buddies with, correct? How did that happen? And I told them it's energy. You know, it all depends on what energy you put out there. And that energy comes back to you, you know, in abundance. I think exactly. Malaysia loves me and I love Malaysia back.
I can already feel it, Ethel. Well, having said that, you are in a country that gives so much of stress and importance on tourism. And you are from you like me are from Goa, and we always try to keep our Goan flag flying high. What is the lesson that the administration or the people in power in Goa should take as compared to what you see in Malaysia?
Right. So, and I'm going to be very frank here. I love Goa. You know, it is the land of my father. I mean, my father, you know, intentionally decided to bring us back from Kuwait to settle back into Goa. So I, as I grew up, I saw the, you know, what was the reason for even doing that. Goa, Frankie, has so much potential to be one of the best tourist destinations in the world. Everybody in Malaysia, whoever I've interacted with, the minute I say I'm from Goa, their eyes just pop up, you know, with sunshine. And they say, oh my God, we love Goa. What are you doing here? You know, because we want to be in Goa and you've left Goa and you've come here, you know. And I tell them, come, I'll take you back to Goa because now you know me. So you know everybody, you know, by default. I see so much of love for Goa in Malaysia. Some of them have been to Malaysia, to Goa. You know, I've had some very lovely memories of Goa of the holiday there because I think AirAsia had direct flights from Kuala Lumpur to, you know, Goa during some time. I think Goa has such a great potential to position itself, not only in terms of what, you know, Goa is naturally blessed with, because even Malaysia is, you know, is bountiful in terms of resources and natural resources, beaches and, you know, food and the culture. There's a Portuguese tradition in Malaysia as well, in Malacca, and so does Goa too, you know. There's already a kinship to it. A lot of people in Malaysia who are from Malacca have long distant, you know, cousins and relatives in Goa too. So there's already a familiarity. I really believe that, you know, if the Goa government can really look at our state holistically from the outside perspective. Sometimes when you're within, you can, you know, become very myopic. You just look at things from piecemeal, correct? But when you're out, you look at everything holistically. I myself, you know, in the years that I've been in Goa, strategically, even in my media career with national papers like the Times of India, positioned and wrote about Goa to the national audience. Because, you know, I took upon myself to inform the rest of the, you know, the country as well, you know, during my media stint that, you know, that Goa is such a life, is a lifestyle destination. And therefore already notches higher already, you know, culturally and, you know, the way of life, the language, the comfort of, you know, all communities living together as one. So much, right? So much to it, which is also very visible and evident in Malaysia as well. I've sat down with the government, you know, the chief ministers of the past, saying that I am more than happy to support, and it comes from my heart, you know, to support, use my talents that I have, you know, that we can do something larger, you know, in terms of better in quality, you know, in terms of, you know, the kind of perspective, how we communicate to the rest of the world, because it's very important, you know, communication. And what kind of, you know, quality investment can we even get to Goa? You know, through the kind of ideas that I was talking about. It was always met with enthusiasm, but frankly, nothing went forward, you know. And after some time, you keep pushing, and then you say, okay, you know, you can push just that much. And nothing went forward.
I fully agree with you. On that note, earlier during the day, when we were chatting, you did mention to me something exciting is supposed to be happening in Goa.
Yes.
And you're talking yes. about, let's hear it from you.
Yeah. So I'm besides being the writer that I am, which is, you know, which is my calling, I'm also a smart businesswoman. I see opportunity. I've always looked at everything from, you know, with eyes of being an entrepreneur. And I think that's the reason why most of my bosses, you know, hired me and put me up in, you know, this designations because they saw that I was, you know, not just an employee. I look at everything. I own the business, even if it's their business, you know. So I look at Goa even that way in my stint in Malaysia too, because I've sat down with the Indian embassy, you know, and their friends, close friends with me now, and told them that why don't we bridge Malaysia and India together? Because there's already a similarity. Indians comprise 10% of the Malaysian population. 10% is a big number, you know, and they are doing well. There is opportunity for India to come to Malaysia with whatever India can do in terms of business opportunities and investment. There's opportunity for Malaysians and Chinese from Malaysia to come to India, you know, and invest, because India is such a huge country and it's a very attractive country for investment. So I've been pitching Goa as well. I said, you know, and as I said, they all know Goa and they all love Goa. So I said, why not Goa as well? Because Goa is a lifestyle destination. Everybody in the country knows Goa. Everybody outside Goa, abroad internationally, knows Goa the minute you mention Goa. So there's already, you know, some default PR that's already happening with Goa. So I spoke to a very close celebrity chef friend in Malaysia, who's also part of my book, you know. And he was like, Ethel, I love what you do. We love you and we love India. So why don't you make this happen for us? Because, you know, because everybody knows you and you know everyone and we trust you. So let's make it happen. So I suggested, why not do is, you know, a celebrity restaurant in Goa. And he was like, are you serious? I said, I'm absolutely serious. Because I think, you know, there is potential for that kind of very high-end food, because there is an appreciation of high-end food in Goa already.
Yes.
Yeah, correct. And this particular gentleman is so well known internationally because here, you know, most of the key brands, international brands, very high end, have already partnered with him. He was like, let's make it happen and let's make Goa happen. I think Goa would be very interesting, you know, for, you know, if you find the right investment and the right, you know, support that can, if it can come from Goa and the government as well. We'll just get, you know, this brand and to Goa. That's it. And, you know, and have high-end Malaysians and Chinese and everybody else traveling to Goa for the kind of food that Goa should be known for internationally. Exactly. You know, it's our state. It's our state, Frankie. We got to, you know, promote it as much as we can.
I fully agree with you. Now, something that I'm truly amazed about you, Ethel, in person is you've been there in Malaysia for a little over a year and a half. And
that's
you've
right.
already been brushing shoulders with the cream of Malaysia, okay? Other than your writing skills that you have, you are also doing a heart-to-heart a chat show, which has gone very popular in Malaysia.
That's right.
I often get to watch it from here in Melbourne. How did this all come together?
I think it's just a journalist in me that knows how to see opportunity, create opportunity, and then execute that opportunity. And because I already have, you know, so many media tools and products that I have developed over a good solid 30 years of my media career, I saw the potential of, you know, as I said, bridging India and Malaysia again, using the gifts that I have, which is using communication and creating content, you know, which has content which has value, content that can create value, content that can be networked, you know, with each other, whether it's the industry, whether it's the government, and open up bigger dialogues. So, yes, I'm very happy to say that the Malaysia government watches my shows. The Indian embassy follows, you know, my work very closely. And I'm even more, you know, driven by enthusiasm now, because that's what it is, you know. That's what it is. It is how you connect all these key elements together and then direct that bigger vision for what we want to execute, which is basically, you know, create this nice, healthy dialogue between two countries, people of both the countries, you know, talking about things that affect it, things, you know, that they are passionate about, where they can empower, where they contribute, because there's some fantastic talent in Malaysia, and right from women to men who are doing, including, you know, Indian citizens who are doing fabulously well here. That's a platform for me to bring them on board heart to heart. And they're very candid, you know, and people just open up to me and share a lot of, you know, things that can add value to them too. So that's how heart to heart happened online, and it's technology, so it makes it possible.
Yes. When we're talking about technology now, you are sitting in Malaysia, I'm sitting in Melbourne, and the show is recorded in Goa. There you go.
Yes. There you go. All right. There you go.
Yeah. Something else, something quite, what I would have loved to do is meet another fellow, Goan, who's got his roots connected to Goa. And that's the legend Tony Fernandez. All right.
Yes.
Do we see Ethel because at some point of time getting hold of the big fish?
Yes, you bet. So Tony was on my top list the minute I started my heart to heart. So I had drawn a list of my wish list, as I call it, of, you know, of people who I want as guests on my show. So Tony was, you know, was third in the category after the minister and things like that, because I think Tony is such a, you know, is such an icon himself here, very popular in Malaysia. Of course, you know, the Tony Fernandez story is very appealing, and we all know it from the, you know, the as a businessman and as an entrepreneur, he's contributed so much to Malaysia as well through AirAsia. So Tony is very much on my radar. In fact, I think by hook or by crook, I've promised myself I will get Tony on heart to heart.
All the very best to you. All the very best to you, Ethel. Okay.
Thank you.
Like, at times I often feel having Ethel in Malaysia, Goan and Indian, is there a mission that you have already set up now that you've been there for over a year and a half? Is there a mission that you are on at the moment?
Yes, very much. The mission for me is how I see it, you know, Frankie. We've done and contributed so much already, you know, to the industry at large. And I think 30 years is a lot, you know, to kind of learn and multitask. I'm looking at all, leveraging all that 30 years of, you know, of information, data, you know, that my brain has compressed and put it all together. One, to give back to India, to give back in particular to Goa, to also create a give back to Malaysia, because it has invited me with open arms. And I see that as a give back that can also happen, you know, by default, right? Where you keep creating these linkages, you know, between people, industry, and, you know, the country at large, where you become the action creator, you know, you become the, you know, the fuel, the petrol, you know, to keep sparking all these little engines everywhere. I look at it that way. Also, because I think, you know, I've been, a part of me was so focused on raising both my daughters as well, and that they've become independent, you know, women themselves now. So I look at, you know, suddenly that there's space, right, in my life that I can now completely focus on to utilize it for a bigger agenda. The agenda is this, you know, today it's Malaysia that I'm here. Tomorrow it could be, I don't know, it could be France, it could be the Middle East, wherever God and universe takes me. Because I look at all these things as stepping stones, Frankie. And I think I feel it very deeply in my heart that this is all, you know, like a catalyst. So I've told God to please use me as a catalyst, where you feel I can make a difference, I can be of use to a larger good. which takes care of, you know, me, myself, and which also takes of, you know, takes care of the larger purpose of what we are supposed to do on this planet. I think COVID has, you know, has changed the game for so many, you know, so many people across the planet. We've all kind of, you know, stepped back and looked at what really matters to us and said, you know, let's contribute where we can truly make a difference in people's lives. I think, you know, that's the greater mission. That's a greater mission for me. So I'm just going with the energy of the universe, where, you know, where I'm being led. I just plant my roots, do as much as I can, use it to my advantage, you know, and use it, as I said, you know, to the advantage of, you know, of the host country, you know, that also gives me love back, and move on from there.
Exactly. In a way, you've already answered my next question, Ethel. Another thing, something that I would also want to know from you is, your earlier focus was on writing about Eves, okay?
Yes.
How have you managed to bring that element now that you are in Malaysia?
Oh my God. So I think it is just a natural extension of what I do, Frankie, because I've understood, and I've met so many women's organizations here. You know, I actively engage with them and they actively engage with me, because I think, you know, boundaries and borders don't matter to women. We all have the same issues, irrespective of, you know, where we are. We all have the same challenges. We all have the same difficulties. We all have the same triumphs and sorrows. And I think in Malaysia as well, it's almost the same universe, because, you know, my whole life, I have been a single parent. I've seen things at such close range, right? Because I'm just right there in the middle of, you know, everything that's happening around me. When I traveled extensively in India as well, I saw the same issues with women everywhere, irrespective of, you know, whether they're urban women or rural women. And I see the same in Malaysia as well. So I think the dialogues that I'm also kind of creating with collaborators in Malaysia who are women is basically the same thing, which is in the field of empowerment, because it's the same issues, the same difficulties, the same challenges for Malaysian women, Frankie, in Malaysia as well. And I think that is what kind of connects us, you know, to women, I think wherever I've traveled, because you just kind of connect on the same level that you come from, because you have so much experience to share. And, you know, I guess it's also, you know, empowerment to share, because I'm a very empowered woman myself. You know,
absolutely.
I've been there.
You can feel it in you.
Yes. So a lot of women, you know, reach out to saying, how did you do it all? You know, how can we do it? You know, how can you share, you know, your strengths with us and tell us how do we kind of move on from there? Because the single parent issue, or the single, you know, women issue also in Malaysia is quite a big number.
Exactly.
In terms of statistics and data as well. So, you know, it's the same challenges, Frankie.
Believe me, Ethel, there's very little time that I could have actually got to sit down and chat with you. I think our interview or discussion with you should actually go on more than just the 30, 25 minutes or so. Should definitely go much more than that. But we are really, really struggling for time. I thank you for taking your time out from your busy schedule out there and talking to us. Thank you very much, and all the very best to Ethel, who's been away from India for the last year and a half, and has done so remarkably well as an unofficial brand ambassador of India to Malaysia. Thank you very much for joining us. Thank you very much.